Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am Päivi Mäkiarvela, coming from Åbo Akademi, University Turku, Finland. This work will deal with catalytic deoxygenation of C18 feedstocks to fuels. The work has been made by collaboration with Technical University of Denmark as well. First, I will discuss a little bit of the background of the work. So, what is the difference between biodiesel and green diesel? Biodiesel is, according to definition, fatty acid methyl ester. So, it contains two oxygen atoms in the structure. Usually it's made from edible sources, like triglycerides. It can also be made by non-edible fatty feedstock. Then we have diesel-like hydrocarbon. So that can be made from triglycerides by hydrotreatment or hydrodeoxygenation. And as well we can have edible or non-edible oils as raw materials. This is nowadays very crucial question because fuel should not compete with food or food raw material. Main sources for production of biofuels are soybean and palm oil and rapeseed oil. We have summarized these technologies recently in Kirk Otmer Encyclopedia of Chemical Technology, how to make biofuels from triglycerides and oils. Then we should also discuss what is the difference between biomass here and fossil fuel, fossil raw material. Fossil fuels are extracted, usually they are 7 gigaton annually, but biomass production is huge. It's very abundant raw material. It is composed of carbohydrates, and very little is utilized annually. But there is a big difference chemically. Biomass contains hydroxyl groups, over-functionalized with hydroxyl groups. It contains oxygen. It's very hydrophilic feedstock, whereas fossil feedstock is hydrocarbon, hydrophobic feedstock. So if there is different type of feedstock, we also should develop a different type of process technology. This is a key question. Here I have summarized now reaction schemes for production of biodiesel and green diesel, this box here. So when we start from triglyceride and have transesterification of triglyceride with methanol, we produce FAME, fatty acid methyl ester, as well as glycerol as a byproduct. Typically acidic or base catalyst can be used. But then when we want to make green diesel, so typically we use a little bit hydrogen, which is also of course a cost also, and a catalyst. Catalyst can be metal supported catalyst, like nickel, molybdenum on aluminum oxide, typically used in hydrotreatment. If this is, for example, tristearine, C18 triglyceride, so in hydrotreatment we produce C18 hydrocarbon. We also produce water and propane. But in catalytic deoxygenation we produce heptadecane, C17 hydrocarbon. And then either we produce CO2, like decarboxylation and propane, or decarbonylation, CO, carbon monoxide, and propane. So these routes produce green diesel. Here is also summarized different technologies. So we have a fatty acid methyl ester, it's esterification. Like here is a chemical structure. We can have hydrotreatment. This is next BTL technology. This is a commercial technology already. It's producing C18 hydrocarbon from stearine. And then we have gasification from biomass via Fischer-Tropsch route. But this last one, biomass gasification, is not realized yet in full scale, only from coal, from non-renewable resources in big scale, or natural gas. Existing plants are in Malaysia, Qatar, and Ras Laffan. In this talk, I will concentrate mainly on hydrotreatment and catalytic deoxygenation to make green diesel. So here is one slide also from Neste Oil, Finnish oil refinery, showing the difference in NEXBTL and FAME quality and conventional diesel. So biggest difference is here, this is oxygen content. FAME contains quite much oxygen. This is also little bit causing corrosion for the motors. And it, for example, in Finland, it cannot be used very much. It's only blended to fuel. What is also good for this renewable sources, so sulfur content is quite low, typically. Here is a flow sheet of the NEXBTL process. So first we have bio oil, like vegetable oil. Then it should be purified, because it contains, for example, phospholipids. So it's pre-treated by acid, caustic, and water to take off, adsorb to clay, phosphorus. And then the feed goes in the next step, to the hydrotreatment unit. In this box, we are converting triglycerides to hydrocarbon, and we also need hydrogen here. And then we have a ready product. It can also be pointed out here that in this system we can have two different catalysts. First can be nickel molybdenum aluminum oxide hydrotreatment catalyst, followed by zeolite, which makes the fuel cold stability better. It isomerizes paraffins to isoparaffins, and then the fuel has better cold properties. As a feedstock, it can be used rapeseed oil, palm oil, soya oil. But also nowadays in Finland we are using waste animal fat as a raw material. Here are the scales. In Finland we have two times nearly 200 kilotons annually, two factories in Porvo. Then Neste has also built in Singapore and in Rotterdam quite big units. But of course, if it's compared globally, so it should be pointed out still that this biofuel business is relatively small. Here is a slide showing a comparison between hydrotreatment and deoxygenation. So what is the difference here? We have used tricaprolin there in this publication as a feedstock. It means C8 hydrocarbon triglyceride. And here you can see conversion as a function of temperature with nickel molybdenum oxide alumina catalyst. So this reaction is consecutive. It goes first to caprylic acid, which is an intermediate, and thereafter we produce C8 hydrocarbon. So this is hydrotreatment. And you can also see here that the product distribution is dependent on the temperature. But the main product is C8 hydrocarbon. Whereas in deoxygenation we use noble metal catalyst, carbon on mildly acidic active carbon, palladium on active carbon. Caprylic acid is an intermediate, but then the main product, final product, is C7 hydrocarbon. It's decarboxylation, and traces of C8 are formed. Of course, we should point out here that product distribution is dependent on the temperature. When we started this work of catalytic deoxygenation, so it was in year 2002, so there were only, for example, benzoic acid, an aromatic carboxylic acid found in literature, but not any papers of linear fatty acids decarboxylation. So that's why a huge research work was started. We tested roughly about 70 different catalysts, different metals and supports, metals, noble metals, platina, palladium, then also nickel and molybdenum, which are not noble metals, ruthenium, iridium, osmium, then different supports like metal oxides, alumina, silica, magnesium oxide, zeolites, acidic supports, mesopurous materials, carbonous materials, and then different metal contents. The results are summarized here. We can see selectivity to the desired product C17 hydrocarbon as a function of stearic acid conversion. And this corner is the most interesting. These catalysts are active and selective. So what were they? They were palladium on carbon, platina and palladium on carbon, platina on carbon. So noble metal with mildly acidic microporous support, which is, has high surface area. It's also, we should point out here, no hydrogen was used. These results are under helium, so we pressurized the reactor so that everything was carried out in a liquid phase. This was the idea. Ruthenium on magnesium oxide, a basic catalyst, was very active, as you can see. But the main product was stearone, a dimeric ketone, which is here. Then some catalysts which were not very active was, for example, this conventional hydrotreatment catalyst, nickel molybdenum oxide alumina, rhodium silica, which is not acidic, ruthenium on silica, iridium on alumina. And here we have intermediate catalysts like nickel chromite and so on. So we concentrated on this corner in the forthcoming experiments. And then we wanted to test the effect of feedstock. We studied stearic acid, like acid, ester and triglyceride, in order to see what is the difference in the feedstock. And in all the cases we got the main product, carbon dioxide and C17 hydrocarbon heptadecane. Here are summarized conversion and selectivity. This pink color is conversion, and these are selectivities, these blue bars. So finally we can see that with all the feedstocks we got quite high selectivities to the desired product, N-heptadecane. And it was either with inert atmosphere or with small content of hydrogen in the atmosphere. Then we still wanted to study effect of reactant unsaturation. Linoleic acid, oleic acid and stearic acid were studied. Linoleic acid contains two double bonds, ethylenic double bonds. Here we can see in the plot, this is fatty acid molar fraction as a function of time. So initial rates were about the same here. But then the catalyst deactivation was very rapid after 10 minutes reaction time, which we can see here. Whereas then most tolerant conditions were with stearic acid and oleic acid. So more deactivation with linoleic acid as a feedstock. Then we wanted also to study the effect of reactor configuration. So we tested either batch mode, everything in batch, or then in such a way that hydrogen gas is flowing through the reactor, so semi-batch mode. Or this is, excuse me, argon, inert atmosphere argon. And the ethyl stearate was the model compound. So what we can see here as a result is that semi-batch reactor gives quite much higher conversion. And the question is why? It's due to the reason that you remember one product was carbon monoxide. Carbon monoxide is a catalyst poison. So now when the gas is flushing the catalyst during the reaction, so we can get higher conversion. So semi-batch mode, gas mode is better. Then we managed to make a patent also. It was published patent application 2006 US patent out of these results. But this was not enough. We wanted to continue with industrially more relevant studies. So we made a continuous reactor. It's a fixed bed reactor here. And wanted to test stearic acid as a feedstock. It has a melting point above 60 degrees. It's like a candle. So what does it mean? We should heat up everything, and in the heated line, the melted stearic acid was pumped through the catalyst. Then we can here take a liquid phase sample, and also we could take online IR analysis of CO and CO2 gas phase products. Here is a liquid collector, this one. And the first result is here, catalytic continuous deoxygenation of neat stearic acid. Catalyst is palladium on carbon. And here we can see that this is reactant, this rectangular here. So it means that with time on stream, stearic acid concentration increases. What does it mean? So it means that catalyst is a little bit deactivating. This first 1,200 minutes are under argon atmosphere. Finally, when we then switch to small amount of hydrogen in the gas phase and reach the steady state conversion so that we got heptadecane as a main product here, about 15 mole percent. You can see here heptadecane formation. So we were happy that we could demonstrate continuous deoxygenation of neat stearic acid. Then we continued the work and a little bit longer time on stream here recorded. This dark blue line is now, it's stearic acid, so this is liquid phase mass balance. We wanted to see the effect of argon if we put a little bit more hydrogen, 5% hydrogen in argon, and so on, like step changes. So now we can see this green line, it's heptadecane. So we can see that very long time here, the selectivity was more than 90%. This is one, like molar fraction is 100% here, the blue line. But because the flow rate of gas and liquids were quite small, so finally this reactor was a little bit plugged in between, and then we continued to flush it again. But we can principally see that we got quite stable performance here, and this is CO2 decarboxylation and CO decarbonylation lines. Heptadecene is formed, an unsaturated C17 hydrocarbon, little bit, very little amount. Then finally we studied technical grade 3 stearine as a feedstock. It was made in 5 volume percent hydrogen in argon. because we wanted to little bit inhibit catalyst deactivation. What was the result? Here is a molar fraction of different compounds with time on stream. So we can see that C17 hydrocarbon is the main, heptadecane is the main product. Because it was technical grade, so there is also a little bit C17 formed, C15 formed. So from stearic acid it was formed C17, and from palmitic acid C15 hydrocarbon. Here are the gas concentrations online. It was also a little bit formed, very traces of C18, like meaning that there was hydrotreatment of stearic acid. We checked later on that there was no traces of C19 carboxylic acid, so it means that this was coming from hydrotreatment of stearic acid. If you are interested more, so you can read in this paper, which is quite recently published. But what is also visible very clearly here, so we have catalyst deactivation, because the yield of C17 goes down. And then the relevant question is, why catalyst deactivation is occurring? We carried out 10 studies, transmission electron microscopy of the spent catalyst, and the result revealed, here is a palladium particle size distribution, that there was no sintering of palladium at 300 degrees C under these conditions. This was very nice result, of course. But then we should ask, why catalyst deactivation? Then we concluded that in the catalytic deoxygenation, so we get heptadecane, we get carbon dioxide decarboxylation, but we also got very little amount of unsaturated hydrocarbons, heptadecene, like decarbonylation route here. And that can further undergo to dehydrogenation and cyclization. So what we got was C17 aromatic hydrocarbon. And that we believe is the main reason for the catalyst deactivation. It's coking by formation of C17 hydrocarbons, aromatic ones. We have published quite many papers during these years, so you can easily find out them if you want to read more about this technology. And then to the conclusions. So I hopefully have demonstrated here that biofuels are needed because fossil fuel is depleted. It has an increasing importance. Then we have two different types of biofuels, biodiesel and then hydrotreatment technology. They are like, biodiesel contains oxygen, whereas this hydrotreatment technology produces green diesel. We have studied very many catalysts and found out selective catalysts for deoxygenation of renewable feedstock. After extensive catalyst screening work, characterization, catalyst development as well, and reaction optimization. Reaction optimization also contained studies of the reaction in different reactors, like batch, semi-batch, and continuous mode.